Okay. Been able to contact Don Corder, and he's in Moscow, I believe. And he is going to come on in a moment and join us at least for a short while to talk about the film. So as soon as he comes on, we'll switch over to that. Let me just start by saying welcome everybody to Sunday mornings at the Marxist Library. We're having problems contacting our speaker. Don said that he's having problems contacting Jeff from inside Russia. So there could be some telecommunications issue going on, but hopefully we'll have Don joining us in a moment or two, do a short session with him to he can answer questions. Just want to let everybody know this is part of our regular Sunday mornings at the Marxist Library series. We want to invite people to participate in our series, to go to our website and sign up for email notifications of for upcoming programs. And you can also view past programs on the website that we have shown. We've been doing this for about 16 years now. Originally out of Oakland at the Nebo Proctor Marxist Library, but for the past few years on Zoom since COVID. And we have speakers and participants from all over the world. Again, you can find out more about our presentations and sign up for our email list on icssmarx.org. Now, I don't see Don coming on yet. Let me just check. There could be some sort of a problem, but hang on just one second. Let me go over to Telegram and see.
Okay, while you say that, let me say that Jeff Monson was our guest speaker today, and he's not been able to come, so we're hoping to get Don Corder, and we showed a section of the movie 8 years before. That shows what was going on after the Maidan coup. So, Alan, I think just so that people are aware when they start seeing this, that they know what's going on here, not get confused. That's fine.
Thank you very much, Raj. Very much appreciated. Okay, Don is in the house. So.
Okay.
If you want to make him a co-host so that he can unmute, that would be good.
I will. Yeah, okay. I will. Yeah.
Quarter. Let me find it. Don, are you there?
How's it going?
Good. Hey. You are on now.
All right, great. Yeah, sorry that Jeff fell off the face of the earth. I hope everything's okay. I wasn't able to get in touch with him either, but of course, for the sake of the meeting, I thought I'd drop everything and jump on. So I'd be happy to talk about whatever you comrades want to hear. Did you watch part of the documentary already?
Yeah, let me just give you background. I know you dropped in the middle of everything, and we showed, I guess, about the first 10 minutes or so of the documentary. People also were sent the link as part of the invitation to view the documentary. So people have seen at least a little bit. If you could just maybe speak a little bit about what, well, of course, introduce yourself. I haven't introduced you.
Yeah, that's
but right. Briefly speak about how you made the documentary, what motivated you to make the documentary, and also tie that in a little bit into the situation in Donbass leading up to the special military operation launch in February. And if you even want to comment today. So really, really happy that you're able to jump in on this and understand you're kind of dropped in the middle, but we really appreciate it, Don. So why don't you go ahead?
Yeah, I'm happy to do it. So my name's Donald Corder. For anyone who doesn't know me, I'm the editor-in-chief of the Revolution Report, which is somewhat of an information collective. We write articles and make videos, and we made this documentary. So I have a couple comrades who work with me on that as well. I also am a journalist for Rush Today. I live in Moscow. But this documentary was actually an independent project that I did with Jeff Monson, because Jeff Monson is also a a communist, and he lives in Moscow as well. So when I moved here, we got in touch and we decided to, you know, collaborate on stuff like this. And we eventually came to the conclusion that we wanted to do a documentary about the conflict in Donbass back before the special military operation. We decided we were going to do this at the beginning of 2021 because this was a conflict that was pretty important to us. We had been to Lugansk and Donetsk many times since the Euromaidan coup d'etat of 2014. And we knew the truth about it. I mean, we saw how people suffered at the hands of the Ukrainian military, you know, literal neo-Nazis. We went to the museums that have, you know, proof proof that supports the Russian narrative of the conflict and refutes the Western one. You know, the kind of stuff you could see in the museums in Lugansk and Donetsk, the kind of propaganda that the Ukrainians tried to drop on, you know, the people of Lugansk and Donetsk in 2014, 2015, saying, you know, come back to Ukraine or you're going to get cholera. We'll make sure you don't have clean water or anything like that. You know, that all obviously really made us passionate about this conflict, made us upset. And by the time it was 2021, we felt like the conflict was pretty frozen and people weren't really talking about it that much. They were talking about it a little in the Russian media, but obviously not at all in the Western media. And we found this to be a bit of an injustice because it had been at that point 7 years since everything began and people were still being killed in this conflict. The Ukrainians were still continuing to bomb civilian areas. So we wanted to make a documentary to bring more attention to this conflict for people in the West so they could know that this war is still going on. The people who are committing it are basically neo-Nazis and they're getting weapons from Western taxpayers. So we went to Donbass and Lugansk. We went to Lugansk and Donetsk in the summer of 2021 and in November, so around the winter, like fall, almost winter time of 2021 as well, to do actual filming of this documentary. So I don't know how many of you have seen the whole thing or whatnot, but it's mainly interviews with people who actually lived through this conflict. My narration is a bit, you know, to explain what might not be so clear to someone who's just learning about this conflict for the first time. But generally, the information, you know, the narrative comes from the mouths of people who actually lived there. And I think that's what makes the documentary the most potent, because, you know, we talked to people who lived by the front line. They told us themselves about how the Ukrainians killed their friends, were torturing them, bombed their villages. We talked with the Night Wolves who gave their side of the story in terms of how they say that Russia didn't help them in 2014 and 2015 militarily. That's the West says that Russia did help them. But according to the people there who fought to defend the People's Republics, they say they had no military support from Russia. And they give some evidence for that as well that you can see in the film. I thought that was important to add in. But of course, we weren't done with the documentary when the special military operation began. And we didn't expect the situation to develop that way. We didn't know what was going to happen. So at that point, when the documentary was already in the process of being completed, we realized that we needed to radically transform the purpose of the documentary, because there was a lot of stuff that happened at that point that our documentary would have looked like outdated at the moment of its release, if we didn't address the special military operation and everything. So now the purpose of the documentary is really to show people in the West the reason for why Russia launched its special military operation in the first place, because so many people in the West, in the Western media, officials are pushing this narrative. They just say that Russia attacked its peace-loving Ukrainian neighbor without any sort of provocation, and that this is like an imperialist fascist attack on Ukraine that was just minding its own business and not doing anything. So most people don't even know that this war started in 2014 when Ukraine launched its so-called anti-terrorist operation, which was basically them sending the military to the Luhansk and Donetsk People's Republics that declared independence through democratic referendums. Kiev sent the military to basically suppress them and say, you're not going anywhere. And that's when the war started and they defended themselves. So this special military operation, you know, it's a continuation of the war, but it's definitely not what started it. It's what's going to end it. And that is exactly what Vladimir Putin and the Russian government wanted to accomplish by the special military operation in the first place. It was intended to end the conflict because, you know, they had these so-called Minsk protocols for years that they negotiated with the Ukrainian side, with several European powers as well. I think it was Merkel and Macron were there, and the leaders of the People's Republics and representatives from the Russian Federation were also there. They all, in 2015, negotiated the Minsk II agreements, which were supposed to broker a ceasefire in Ukraine and lead to some sort of peace down the road. Ukraine constantly violated them. You know, the government said we're abiding by them on paper, but they did nothing to stop the neo-Nazis and nationalist battalions that were on the border from violating it constantly. I mean, Ukraine's plan was clearly clearly a war of attrition. They wanted to just, you know, grind down the willingness to fight of the Donbass people slowly but surely until they were like, okay, we've had enough. But they clearly don't understand that the people in Donbass are, you know, they're really, their national spirit. It's not something that can be that can be done to. I don't think they're very you know, people that are proud of their anti-fascist history, and they're, you know, they're never going to surrender to this fascist regime in Kiev. Yeah, that's so these Minsk agreements, I mean, they weren't working. Ukraine was constantly violating them. And then on the eve of Russia's special military operation, or its launch, actually, you know, we got to remember also that Russia was not the first side to start these hostilities around that time. I mean, in the documentary, I interview an official from the Luhansk People's Republic, you know, who lives there. And she said that the frequency of Ukrainian strikes against civilian positions a week and 2 weeks before the Russian military operation increased 400 times. It was like incredible how much the frequency of these strikes, you know, increased. It started to become clear that Ukraine was preparing for another major offensive. They wanted to finally reconquer basically the Luhansk and Donetsk People's Republics that declared independence. And they didn't care, you know, what the Minsk agreements said about that. And that much was even clear because, you know, there was also an evacuation of civilians called before Russia's military operation began, because the Ukrainians were making life unbearable in the People's Republics. Like, thousands of people had to flee to Russia. And actually, my job sent me to a border town of Russia because there was a huge story to cover. I spoke with a lot of these people who were forced to evacuate on the eve of Russia's military operation because Ukraine made life there so miserable. And they all said the same thing, you know, like they hadn't seen shelling that bad since 2015, you know, which was the height of Ukraine's anti-terrorist operation. Well, that's what they call it. It's really a war against Donbass. So, you know, Russia had finally had enough at that point, and on top of that, they were trying to, you know, amidst talk of including Ukraine and NATO, you know, Sergei Lavrov, Russia's foreign minister, and other officials from Russia's foreign ministry were constantly meeting with Western officials to come to some sort of agreement that would exclude Ukraine from NATO, because Russia felt that including Ukraine and NATO would violate the national security of Russia, which is, you know, completely against many security agreements that were reached between European countries and Russia itself. They said that, you know, you can't, these agreements say that military alliances cannot be expanded at the expense of the national security of any other European country. So NATO says it's a defensive alliance, but Russia says we feel our national security is threatened. So this is, you know, this is in violation of these treaties we all signed. And NATO just said, you know, anyone who wants to join us, we'll let them in. You know, they just didn't even give any sort of credence to diplomacy with Russia. So in a sense, that also contributed to this. But really the main thing was this, you know, increased Ukrainian bombardment, the preparation for a new offensive, preparation to completely and bluntly violate the Minsk agreements more than they had been before. And even now, we've heard statements, you know, in hindsight from Merkel, Angela Merkel, the former German chancellor, and from Pyotr Poroshenko, who was the first president of the post-Euromaidan government. And they even say themselves that the Minsk agreements were intended to buy time for Ukraine to prepare for a conflict with Russia. So they weren't actually like negotiating these Minsk protocols in good faith. They were not trying to secure peace, and they admit it. They said they were just trying to buy time for Ukraine. So, you know, this is one thing that Putin says is one of the biggest mistakes they made, putting their faith in the Minsk protocols, because they really believed that the European powers were trying to negotiate on equal terms with them, but they were wrong, you know. Actually, when I was in Kyrgyzstan, I was at a press conference where Vladimir Putin spoke at, and that's exactly where he said, I saw him say it in person, he's like, we were deceived when it comes to the Minsk protocols. They were completely deceived, and, you know, They put their faith in you know, fair diplomacy with Europe. So that's not good. But another thing I wanted to say is that a lot of people in the West, especially in leftist organizations, which is what bothers me the most, say that this is like an imperialist war and that like Russia is fascist. But this couldn't be further from the truth. The first political organization that started pushing for like scrapping the Minsk protocols and giving and recognizing the independence of the People's Republics and giving them direct aid. The first organization in Russia to call for that was the Communist Party. The Communist Party of the Russian Federation was the first organization to call for direct involvement in Lugansk and Donetsk to defend the People's Republics. So they were like the first people for calling. They at the beginning, they weren't like, we need a special military operation, but they were like, they said we needed some sort of military action here because it wasn't being solved on its own. So the Communist Party was the first one to suggest this. And they actually ran like a political campaign in the government to put pressure on Putin's administration to take a you know, bigger hand in the situation. So this isn't like an example of some evil imperialist capitalist government attacking some peace-loving neighbor. This is the result of you know, the Russian government, which is capitalist, but it's not the same kind of capitalist government in the West. I mean, it's a capitalist government that's run by a bureaucracy that is like, I consider it Bonapartist. It's very often, I think, caught between the interests of the the Communist Party, which is the biggest opposition party, the second biggest party in the entire country. The Putin's administration is caught between the interests of the working class and the Russian oligarchs, who are not in charge. You know, they're oligarchs. They're allowed to retain their wealth because they follow Putin's rules. This was, decided back in the early 2000s when, Putin actually had sit downs with them, and he was like, look, you can get with the national program or you're gonna have problems. Some got with the national program, some didn't. And those who didn't, you know, now are wanted in Russia and they can't return, you know. One example of that is probably Bill Browder, if you guys know him, but that's a whole other story. My point is that this is not an imperialist war. This really is a war of national liberation in Donbass. The Lugansk and Donetsk People's Republics are majority Russian. That's a fact. Everyone speaks Russian there. They do not speak Ukrainian. And they were discriminated against because of that by Kiev, which is on the other side of the country and sees themselves as having a different national identity. And you know, there's a lot I can talk about on this subject, but basically from what I've seen in Ukrainian media and text, like the Donbass people were considered like garbage by a lot of these nationalistic Western Ukrainians, the neo-Nazis, by all these people who basically, you know, tie their political heritage and lineage to Nazi collaborators in World War II. And even before that, they were, involved in the formation of an anti-communist government in Ukraine around the Russian Civil War. You know, there was also a time, but even before World War II, where the Germans and Austrians had taken control of part of Ukraine. And there were a lot of collaborators with them as well. But, you know, it's a really complicated situation with that. So as far as like what the situation now, there's a lot of theories as to what's going on. I read an interesting one that says that the conflict has been like stalemated for a bit on purpose by Russia, because it says and it's pretty much irrefutable that the Western weapons that are being supplied to the Ukrainian military, huge amounts of them are just getting there and being destroyed, because Russia has very high precision missiles that it's using against not only that, but also against the energy infrastructure in Ukraine, and military targets as well. Of course, the Ukrainian military has HIMARS rockets, but they're not using them in the same way. I think they're mostly using them, you know, for terror purposes, because when I've been hearing about the use of HIMARS rockets, usually it's against civilian infrastructure. So there's that theory that Russia is actually purposely drawing this out for a while to basically slowly grind down the Ukrainian military. And then they're going to launch a huge offensive with the troops they've mobilized at one certain point. I'm not really sure at this point. I thought it was going to play out a little bit differently. I thought, you know, and I still think it's possible that there's going to be like a winter offensive, or maybe like an offensive at the end of winter, early spring, maybe, that is going to take place after they really disable Ukraine's energy infrastructure en masse. So yeah, that's how I think the conflict's going now. And I think a Russian victory is inevitable, to be honest. It's just a matter of time, you know. And I think the West knows that too. And the West's goal has been to, you know, give Russia the biggest possible bloody nose it can before that inevitable Russian victory. And, yeah, you know, the worst thing about it is that, and I got to say, this is the biggest difference between the way Russians see the conflict and a lot of people in the West. Like, there's been so much anti-Russian hatred in the West over all this. And in Russia, they don't even, I've never run into someone who hates Ukrainians. Like, everyone understands this conflict. Well, either they're liberal and they agree with the Western line of thinking, or they support the Russian government in this, but they don't hate Ukrainians. They see this as NATO playing, two formerly brotherly nations, fraternal nations against each other. And that, you know, we all look at it as an unfortunate situation where Ukrainians are being used as the foot soldiers of Western imperialism, where, you know, Americans are telling them what to do, you know, Germans are telling them what to do, and, you know, they don't really, they're fulfilling the foreign policy goals of the Western imperialist core, while none of the people from over there are having to do any of the fighting, unfortunately. So, but yeah, so that's the way I see it all. That's, a brief overview of the documentary, the background of why we decided to do it and how it turned out. I'd be happy to answer some questions if you guys want. Yeah.
Don, let me just ask you, people, if you would, those who want to ask questions, if you'd raise your hand in the on the lower right-hand part of the screen, and we'll take you in the order that you do. But let me, in the meantime, just ask a few questions of Don coming off of what he's talked about and the documentary. First of all, the narrative that's being pushed by segments of the left, kind of the pro-Ukrainian segments of the left, basically very much downplay the initiative and the support and sort of the grassroots effort of resistance on the part of the people of Donbass. And can you say a little bit about what you observe there in terms of grassroots organization and resistance, as well as the People's Republic government bodies? What sort of role did they have in the resistance, especially in the early phases before the special military operation?
Yeah, I can. I could speak more about Lugansk because I spent more time there than Donetsk, but Donetsk, I'm sure, isn't much different. But dude, Lugansk is, it's like, well, let me put it to you this way. The current head of the Lugansk People's Republic was elected in, his primary opponent was the head of the Federation of Trade Unions of the Lugansk People's Republic. And he himself, the current Leonid Pasechnik, the current head of the People's Republic, was like an intelligence officer guy. So, you know, there's no capitalists there. He won only very slightly. Like, the Federation of Trade Unions in Lugansk People's Republic is, I would say, the most powerful civil organization in the region. It's like super powerful. It plays a huge hand in the politics of the situation there. And they took a huge role in helping people and a huge role in civil administration when things were really bad in 2014 and 2015, where there was like no electricity, no water. People's homes were being destroyed. You know, there was constant Ukrainian bombardment. People didn't know what was going on. They couldn't even use the radio, you know, to understand what was going on. The Federation of Trade Unions, their headquarters basically became a center for civil administration and humanitarian aid as well. I spoke to tons of people who work there, who remember those times. And one of them is actually in the documentary, if you guys want to watch it. And they talk about how, you know, people were there sleeping at their desks. People were working 24/7 to help people. And they, you know, at the end of the crisis, they came out as, you know, one of the most powerful civil organizations in the Republic. And they have a hand in everything, organizing everything. And it was also, you know, that way in the Soviet Union as well, obviously, because, you know, the socialist government created a situation where the trade union was involved in everything. So they still are. And that's where it's different from, you know, many parts of modern Russia, where there's not really a strong trade union presence. But in the Lugansk People's Republic, there is. And, you know, they even organize like May Day parades where people are waving socialist Soviet flags, and all the you know, workers are represented in these May Day parades. You know, there's columns of teachers, columns of coal miners, and all this stuff. Like, they basically run the show alongside like civil activist organizations, I guess I would say. There's another big organization of, you know, basically, it's basically a grassroots political organization called Mir Luganchinye. And they're, I think that organization plays the biggest role in politics there, in terms of like the way politics works. And they, when we were filming this documentary, they helped us do everything. They helped us meet people. They asked us, what do you want to do? We told them exactly what we wanted to do, and they were able to show us whatever we wanted. So that's the way everything works there. Yeah, I mean, it reminded me of the Soviet Union, really. It's just they don't call themselves like socialist or anything. Because they wanted to put more emphasis on the fact that they're like Russians ethnically. In terms of Donetsk, there also is a huge trade union movement, but I've heard there's like it's a little more market oriented over there, is what I've heard. But I haven't been there so many times. I don't have that many connections in Donetsk as many as I do in Lugansk. So.
Great, thank you. Okay, so let's go ahead. I'm going to call people a little bit out of order because I've been kind of going back and forth, but I'll go down the list. Let me start with Raj. If you could keep your questions or comments down to about 2 minutes, because we're kind of imposing on Don. We we surprise attacked him to come on and right. speak tonight. So if please go ahead, Raj, unmute yourself and ask your question.
Roger, you mean?
Raj. Hey, Don, first of all, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you. Hi, Raj.
Okay. First of all, I have great admiration for someone who leaves his country and goes and works in another country, especially with the convictions you have. So
thank you. I want
to express that. Second thing is, I have three questions. I have no further comments. First of all, what aspects of socialism, this is a little bit different because this remains an issue because propaganda about Russia and Putin is very intense, as you know, as a representative of oligarchy. I don't think so, but so what aspect of socialism in Russia remains? That's one question. The other question is very simple. What is the nature of the Wagner thing? It's described as also fascist in American. So they say, well, they accuse them, they're equally fascist on both sides because Wagner is a fascist. Please address that. And third one is it really a Bonapartist regime that in Russia, or is it what I think is a dirigist regime, which means it's a transitional in between can go. So it's tied to that first question about what aspect of socialism. So just three questions. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, in terms of the first question, what aspects of socialism are still around? I mean, you know, there's basically, I would say most of what still works is left over from the Soviet Union. Like the education system here is really good. And I mean, it's not as good as it was 20 years ago, but it's still very good. And, you know, it's super cheap.
Public education.
Yeah, education. Yeah, it's
Public education. Yeah,
public education. I mean, yeah. And that's held over from the Soviet Union. I mean, medical care is free. There's like two categories. There's like there's OMS and DMS, they're called. OMS is like free healthcare. And it's not super high quality, but you know, it's still healthcare and lots of people use it. I've used it before. I don't think it's any lower quality than, you know, a lot of hospitals in the United States. But DMS is like if you have a job that gives you special healthcare and everything. So the OMS system is left over from the Soviet Union, and it makes it so that, you know, everyone has access to healthcare. Everything, pretty much everything connected to space technology and weapons technology, with the exception of like new nuclear warheads that Russia's put a lot of money into researching, pretty much all of it is from the Soviet Union. All of it.
Gas and oil industry.
Yeah, gas and oil industry too. Yeah, it's all held over from the Soviet Union, you know. That's essentially that. In terms of your I forgot the second question, so I'm gonna go to the
Wagner,
third question.
Wagner, oh, yeah, what Wagner, does it mean Wagner, Wagner.
Yeah. So I don't like that Russia uses the private military companies, private military company in the special military operation. I don't approve of it. I think it's always wrong when you're using people who profit off of war. It's pretty messed up. But at the same time, you know, they are making significant gains, and in terms of the political, I have the word in Russian, Sostav, but I sometimes forget the word in English and remember the word in Russian. In terms of the political substance of the organization, I wouldn't say it's fascist. I mean, the guy who heads it is not a fascist. I would say he's like, you know, just a sort of Russian bureaucrat guy. I don't know. There could be like individual fascists in the organization. I really don't know. I've met people from the Wagner group, actually, when I was when I was, I met them somewhere inside Russia when I was in the Rostov, in a border region of Donbass, I remember. And my experience is that they're just like super, they love being super politically incorrect. I met a lot of people who were like waving ISIS flags and stuff like that, but it's just because they wanted to be scary, you know, to people who didn't like them. So there weren't like, you know, there were tons of people, you know, waving ISIS flags and stuff like that. I don't know. They're just like crazy mercenaries. Unfortunately, that's who they are. So. In terms of the Bonapartist thing, the reason I think this is because, the description that you gave the Russian government probably has a lot in common with the way I see it. I mean, it's like it could go either way, is what I think. And like my understanding of a Bonapartist state, based on, you know, what Marx wrote in the 18th Brumaire of Louis Bonaparte, is that a Bonapartist state is, you know, a government that is basically run by a state bureaucracy. It's not capitalists that run the state bureaucracy, but there's, you know, a kind of strong man who is a military man, an intelligence man, who has a group of these like sort of intelligence officers and military officials around him that control the state bureaucracy, that the oligarchs are basically like bound to, but it's not the oligarchs that control it. And so because of that, there's a socio-political situation created where the society, where the acts of the state don't always represent the interests of the bourgeoisie. Sometimes they represent the interests of the proletariat. And in this situation, I think it's a clear example of that, the special military operation, because what has this done for the Russian bourgeoisie? First of all, the ruble strengthened in value very significantly. This meant that that these oligarchs lost huge amounts of their holdings because it became very, very difficult for them to compete with the foreign capitalists. This is a natural phenomenon that happens, obviously, when the national currency appreciates in relation to foreign currencies. And also the currency, you know, the ruble got stronger. That meant that Russian salaries of workers became stronger in relation to other salaries. It meant that they had more access to travel and they had more access to foreign goods. So the economic decisions, the economic consequences of this were actually positive for the Russian worker, and it was bad for the Russian oligarch. And that's why we really don't see that much Russian oligarch support for this special military operation. The way I see it is that like a lot of them are keeping their mouths shut and they're a little scared that they're going to keep losing money. And again, also, like I said, this was originally a proposal of the Communist Party, again, not an oligarch organization, but the Communist Party, you know. I think generally Putin's trying to like represent the national interest of Russia. But I can tell you, as someone who's living in Russia, like Russians don't even really understand what their national identity is. They don't know if they should try to be something different from the Soviet Union. They don't know if they should, some like cling to the Soviet identity. Some say we need something new. Even the ones that are on the left, you know, there's even like some dispute on whether or not we should go back to the Soviet Union or maybe make something new, you know, if it's even possible to go back to the Soviet Union. So there's kind of an identity crisis in Russia right now. And I think that's one of the ways this sort of regime has materialized as well. So
thank you.
Okay, next is Roger, followed by Janet, Yusuf, Richard Wright, and then Sharon Rose. So Roger Harris, please unmute yourself.
Okay, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, well, Alan, first of all, I should commend Alan Miller for going to Plan B so quickly and so well. It was very nicely done. Thank you. And Don, thank you for coming on board at the last minute and sort of helping us understand what's happening in your little corner of the world. I have a question, and I'll start with a quote. And it, it, please apologize. I have to apologize for the quote is actually from my an article I wrote just 2 weeks after the Russian special operation, and the article I put it in the chat is it was in Counterpunch, and I just read it really quickly to see, well, did I get things right or wrong back then? The article is when did Ukraine war begin? And the second paragraph says the conception that the war started on February 24 of this year is like viewing the quote invasion of the US and its allies of Normandy in June 1944 against the quote sovereign and quote democratic Vichy French as the start of World War II. So I'll get to the question. Never mind that the Vichy government was a puppet of the Nazis, that the opportunity to negotiate had long been rejected, that the war had been raging for years, and that the only option for stopping the Nazis was militarily.
We lost your voice.
Roger, we lost your sound. Did you mute?
Okay. Can you hear me now? So that was within 2 weeks into the conflict. You know, things were, at least for North Americans like myself, not very clear. Now it seems so obvious that the war did not start on February 24th. It started at least in 2014, but it had antecedents even before that. Mm-hmm. And that it appears fairly obvious that when you try to say, well, what other options did the Russians have other than the invasion that took place, if you call it an invasion, it's very hard to see what other options they could possibly have had. Those options were really precluded long before. And so there was a real inevitability that you could see looking at this in retrospect. More recently, Angela Merkel sort of told us that that was their thinking all along, but that wasn't much of a revelation because we have the United States security documents that long before Merkel, you know, spilled the beans, very clearly indicated that the U.S. foreign policy has been for a long time to disarm and dismember and unbalance Russia. So my question for you, Don, because we really look to people like you for giving us insights into this situation, is that I believe there were a number of people who said the Russians would not invade, a number of people who sort of poo-pooed that idea. Now it seems obvious that they were massing on the Ukraine border precisely to have a military operation. So why did folks at that time who were sympathetic to the, or maybe I should say, people who were opposed to the NATO mission, why did they misread the question of whether Russia would cross the border?
Well, I think that's a really good question. And I agree with pretty much everything you said before that as well. I think you got it completely right with your article. This is pretty much the same stance I have on the whole situation. The reason why I think they didn't get it right is because it wasn't really set in stone, I don't think. I think in hindsight, looking back at what happened, especially because I was, you know, reporting throughout on the whole thing, I saw it step by step happen. I really don't think that Russia was dead set on attacking Ukraine. I think at one point it was I think it was at the end of 2021 or at the very beginning of 2022 that it was like, okay, we have to have a military solution in our back pocket if things don't work out. Because the entire time from like October 2021 all the way up until like a week before the special military operation in February of 2022, the officials from Russia's foreign ministry were constantly meeting with Western officials to try to come to some sort of agreement. Like if they were able to come to an agreement on Ukraine staying a neutral country, not joining NATO, and I think that would have been enough, to be honest. I think that would have prevented a Russian military operation from happening. And of course, it also has to do with the decisions that Ukraine took as well. But again, I think they were like kind of pretty much coached into that by the Pentagon. As we know, you know, pretty much all of the major military decisions Ukraine's making right now these strategies come from the Pentagon. You know, it's like the same thing in South Korea, how all, you know, the South Korean military is completely controlled by the US military. It's the same thing in Ukraine. So my point is that I think if the US for some reason were more willing to negotiate and came to some sort of agreement with Russia to keep Ukraine a neutral place, I think there wouldn't have been a sort of intensification on the Ukrainian side. And I don't think that Russia would have used those troops that it was amassing on the border. Because remember, the Russian narrative of these troops was that they were having military exercises. And if everything went fine with the negotiations, they could have easily said, yeah, they were just military exercises. Now they're going home and nothing's going to happen. So I don't think, I think it was a situation that was changing very rapidly, and that even the Russian government wasn't thinking, okay, in February, we're going to attack Ukraine. I don't think they thought that. I think they made that decision like, I think they decided to cross the Rubicon, so to say, very close to when the actual military operation was launched.
Okay, next is Janet. And what we're going to ask everybody to do to try and make this more time efficient, please try to keep your questions and comments down to about 2 minutes and focus on questions. So, Janet, if you would unmute and go ahead.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Don. I missed the first part of what you had talked about, but I basically see things the same way as you and Roger. The left in the US also has an identity crisis, in my opinion, quote left, whatever that means anymore. I believe Putin has said that had it not been for the deception by Merkel and Poroshenko and Hollande, they're admitting that Minsk was just a delaying tactic, that this military operation would have happened in 2014 or around then. That said, I wanted to share a little bit of my critique about the documentary. I appreciate all the work you guys put into it, but I found the it was over-narrated, kind of having a splainer throughout, and the background music, constant background music, was for me a turn off. I have to say that. I wondered what the audience was that you are appealing to with the documentary, and because it seemed similar to pro Ukrainian propaganda, even. I mean, it was factual, but just the style I had issues with. So I'd like you to address that. And one other question I had, is there homelessness in Russia? What's the housing situation there?
Sure, yeah. Well, with the documentary, I saw in the comment section, a lot of people found the music to be really loud, yeah. And we decided to make an abridged version that has the audio completely fixed. So that version is also available on the YouTube channel, and it has less narration as well. Personally, the reason why we included the amount of narration we did was because it was supposed to be for someone who didn't really understand anything about the conflict. I just felt like a lot of times if we were to just throw the viewer into the deep end of the pool with a lot of these interviews, they wouldn't understand enough of the background, like, you know, what the Minsk protocols were, or the whole Euromaidan coup d'etat itself, you know. So that's why we did a lot of the narration. But like I said, this abridged version has a lot less of it, and the music is fixed as well, and it's a lot more of just the interviews. So this was this we decided to make available for people who had those criticisms. And in terms of homelessness, there is homelessness, because like I said, Russia's a capitalist country after all. But I don't think it's nearly as big of a problem as in the United States. I mean, I haven't done like thorough research into homelessness in Russia, but I am from New York and I live in Moscow, two, you know, huge cities, and I could tell you that the contrast is enormous. I mean, homeless people are all over the place in New York, all over the place. Moscow, you see them very rarely.
Was there homelessness in the Soviet Union?
Sorry?
Was there homelessness in the Soviet Union?
No, it was guaranteed by the Constitution. So, but it wasn't free though. This is something that a lot of people mix up. Housing in the Soviet Union was not free, but it was like super low. It could not exceed, by law, it couldn't exceed a certain percentage of your salary. And, you know, it was made so that everyone had a home to live in, which was because it was guaranteed by the Constitution. So.
Okay, next is Yusuf, followed by Richard, followed by Sharon, and then Jean. So Yusuf, if you would go ahead and unmute and ask your question.
Thank you. I'm on the same page. However, to complete, could you add some words about Crimea?
Yeah. What do you mean?
Well, exactly. Crimea wasn't mentioned, and I think that's still an important part of the whole picture.
Well, I think they had a fair referendum. I don't think there was really anything wrong with it when they decided to become part of Russia. Like the referendum itself had foreign observers. It's just they had foreign observers from countries that the West didn't like Syria and Venezuela. So in terms of what I've seen, because I've been to Crimea, everyone there is Russian. Like nobody speaks Ukrainian there. It's even more Russian than Donetsk and Lugansk, you know, because everyone speaks Russian there too, but they have a specific accent that's generally associated with Ukrainians. In Crimea, there's a lot less of that. They even have like just straight up Russian accents. It's just, and also that's not surprising since Crimea was Russian for a long, long time. It was only Ukrainian between the Khrushchev era and, you know, until recent years. So, yeah.
Okay, next is Richard Wright, followed by Sharon. Richard, please go ahead.
Thank you for your ad hoc presentation. I had a couple observations about what I saw at the beginning. One of which was, and this may have been covered further on in the film. I'm not sure, but one of which was that in fact the Russians gave NATO, NATO a chance to ameliorate their concerns. They gave them something like 6 months before they had the special military operation. And I didn't see any mention of that in the little part I saw. The second thing was I wish you had included Chris Murphy along with John McCain as well as Victoria Nuland to indicate that this was really very much a bipartisan effort. Chris Murphy is now, you know, I mean, he's a nice star for MSNBC, and you know, he should really be brought down for inciting a riot, you know, on the step of a democratically elected government. The third point I had is, you said that this is I can't wonder if this is a little bit too late in the game. I mean, this really should have been out there like 10 years ago, you know. And the fourth point, just briefly, is that to augment what Roger was talking about, I really think that that this sort of goes back to George Bush the Smarter, and in particular, one aspect of that needs to be examined that is getting very short shrift is something called the State Partnership Program, which is where we send our reserves over to various countries, and strangely enough, they just happen to be on the borders of conflicting countries in order to propagate NATO the furtherance of NATO. Okay, I'll shut up there. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks.
Okay, next is Sharon. Sharon, and then followed by Jean. So Sharon, please.
Thank you. I just have a few comments. Thank you very much, Don. With regard to the prospects for the future of this special operation, according to the New York Times, 500 Russian soldiers die every day. And I don't know if that's true, but clearly the casualties on both sides are escalating or accelerating. And I'm wondering what effect that has inside of Russia for support of this operation. So we're told, or we read, that you know, the Soviet involvement in Afghanistan got bogged down, and then mothers got tired of losing their children, to say the least, and it became a thing where the Russian people couldn't support it anymore. And I'm wondering whether what you think about that. And let me see. I just wanted to mention also, so on the occasion of the 100th anniversary of the founding of the USSR, which was beginning of this month, people I know, Marxists I know, have been talking about how that came about and the issues surrounding it. So I have not read about this, but what I hear from some comrades is that Lenin was in favor of more of a federation, and Stalin was more in favor of let's all just be one country. And somehow it developed into the USSR. But in my opinion, there's no way that the people of that huge continent or subcontinent, huge piece of a continent, are going to go back together and become a USSR again. So it's more important to look at the future of the Russian Federation and how, you know, the different opinions about that future. I'll stop there.
I agree with you in terms of reforming the Soviet Union. I think that'd be a long shot. But in terms of the conflict and the morale here, I don't think morale has been significantly affected yet. The kind of stuff, and also in terms of casualties, I definitely do not think it's anywhere near what the Western media is saying. The Russian Defense Ministry has its own numbers, which are obviously completely the other way, which I wouldn't trust 100% either. But in reality, I mean, based on the kind of the tactics we've seen so far, Ukraine has been launching a significantly higher number of offensives than the Russian military. And, you know, offensives cost the military very dearly to launch. I mean, it costs a lot more resources. When you go on an offensive against defensive positions, especially in this conflict, which is basically, you know, very similar to World War I, where people are using artillery most of the time and they're entrenched. Offensives are very costly. And for them to be effective, you need to be ready to lose like, four to five times as many casualties as that of the defender. And so I think Ukraine is losing a lot more than the Russian side. And also another thing that makes me think that is that Ursula von der Leyen even said, I really think she slipped up and she accidentally said that Ukraine had lost 100,000 people since the beginning of Russia's military operation. And this is a much higher figure than the Ukrainian government says or the official Western statistics. And she said this publicly and then backtracked on it. But I think that was a window into what the reality was showing, you know. And this is also another reason why Russia has not taken so much ground recently, because they haven't really launched offensives, to be honest. And that has to do with their goal since the beginning has been the preservation of human life in the military operation. That's why it wasn't launched with carpet bombings. That's why it wasn't launched with using a shock and awe doctrine like the U.S. did in Iraq. For a military operation, it was launched very humanely. As far as conflict can be humane, but you can also listen to what the Ukrainian officials are saying about their own military, about their own aims. And their aim is, you know, we're going to take our territory back at whatever the cost. You know, I really don't think it matters to the Kiev government how many people they're losing. And also, because of the fact that the conflict is happening on Ukrainian soil, it's probably not very difficult to convince people to do that. You know, like, although I wouldn't say that this is I don't say that Russia is like attacking Ukraine in a hostile way. I think Russia's actions are defensive against NATO, but that's kind of difficult to understand just through the perspective of an individual that maybe has never thought about the dialectic between NATO and Russia ever, you know. So to most people in Ukraine who are, you know, conscripts, I would say, that aren't political, but that have been conscripted into the military, they probably feel like they're defending their own home. And, they're riled up by nationalistic propaganda. It makes sense, you know, so.
Okay, we're just going to take a couple more questions and then we'll let Don go. So let's have Gene and then Gulden and then Raj, and I think we'll wrap it up there. So Gene, if you would go ahead.
Okay, well, thanks so much, Don, for producing that and being with us. And, you know, I'm in a total agreement, I think, with the perspective that's offered there. And it's very important because, you know, on the so-called left here in the United States, we have people that are, you know, fervent supporters of the proxy war in Ukraine. I'm thinking of Howie Hawkins and others that, you know, it's two imperialisms and, yeah, you know, we got to fight all imperialism, which I think is totally bogus. So that's one thing. And that includes some people in my own organization, Veterans for Peace. And our local chapter has come out with a statement critical of that, basically saying, you know, no proxy war in Ukraine, bring our troops home, abolish NATO and those things. And I'll put that in the chat just for people to see. But 2 points. One is that we do reference the special relationship statement of the Russian Federation and the People's Republic that was issued on February 4th, 2022. And basically that puts this linkage between the People's Republic of China and Russian Federation. And I, you know, have always said that any friend of Xi Jinping's is a friend of mine. So I think, we do not only try to understand what the Russians are doing, but also support it. So that's one aspect, is the Chinese connection there. It's been said that, China believes that, Russia is taking care of business, but they are not going to let Russia fail. And I don't know exactly how to interpret that. The other thing is that Putin has been accused of threatening to use nuclear weapons. And coming from the United States, I think that's totally bogus. But I'd like you to address that whole issue of, can this turn into a nuclear war? And next week, we do have Mark Albertson speaking on that issue. So those are my two questions, China and nuclear weapons, I think, if you could address them.
Well, with China, I don't know much about that. So I don't really have much to say about it. But with the nuclear weapons, I definitely have a stance on that. I don't think it's going to escalate into a nuclear war. I think nuclear rhetoric is used as like a diplomatic weapon in what's going on right now. But I really believe in the theory of deterrence and mutually assured destruction. And, we're talking about two formal governments, that are actually in conflict right now, like the United States and Russia. If it was like some sort of, if there was like some sort of, fanatical, radical religious organization with nuclear weapons involved, I would think maybe it'd be different. Or even if like Kiev had nuclear weapons, I think they would use them. But that's the reason why the West has not given them anything like that. So I don't think it's going to escalate into a nuclear war, because both sides know the consequences of that, and they're obviously not ready to do that. But the main thing about Putin threatening to nuke the West or nuke Ukraine or use tactical nuclear weapons in Ukraine, I've followed this since the beginning. I never heard him threaten to use tactical nuclear weapons, but what Putin has said, and what Sergei Lavrov has also said, is that the Russian nuclear doctrine is one of responsive strikes. So if they are attacked with nuclear weapons, they will respond with nuclear weapons. That's the Russian nuclear doctrine. That if they're attacked with nuclear weapons, or if the very existence of the Russian state is at stake. So like, if Russia was invaded and Moscow's encircled and, they're about to take the Kremlin, those are the only two situations where Russia's nuclear doctrine allows them to use nuclear weapons. America's nuclear doctrine is one of preemptive strikes. So America's nuclear doctrine does not require America to be attacked by a nuclear weapon for America to use nuclear weapons. That's a much more dangerous concept, and that's something that scares Russia. And I think that doctrine is there to scare people, to be honest. I think it's because, like I said at the beginning of my response here, nuclear weapons are basically used as scare tactics in modern politics, I would say. They're never going to be, I don't think they're ever going to be used for their actual purpose, their actual destructive purpose. I think they're mostly used as weapons in geopolitics.
Okay, next is Gulden, followed by Raj, and then we're going to wrap up on this part of the program today. So Gulden, if you would unmute yourself, you are, and go ahead and ask your question.
Hi, Don. First of all, thank you very much for your presentation and the video. I totally agree that Russians finally took an action to save the people of Donbass and stop the aggression of fascists in Ukraine and stop the aggression of Western countries, of course. And my quote, but there are some people on the left saying that we should be consistent no matter what's going on in Ukraine, whether they want to join to NATO or internal conflict, We should be consistent and we should be against sending troops to a sovereign country, just like we did when US sent troops to Iraq and Syria. What do we say to that people?
Well, I would say that the position that you and I share is consistent. I think to say that like being against war means being against any sort of military action anywhere is a mechanical understanding of what being against war is. Like I personally would refer these people that say that our position is not consistent to elementary books on logic from the USSR and elementary books from political economy. Like I've read them. The reason why I came to Russia was to learn about socialism from Soviet sources that are not translated into English. And, you know, it's widely spoken about that, like, and obviously the Soviet Union was against war constantly, but they also had a huge military industrial complex. And that's because the conclusion they came to after being attacked by the capitalist imperialist world since their foundation was that the only way they can protect themselves is by having a strong military. And, you know, they understand war as having two possible manifestations. There's imperialist war and there's defensive, there's three classifications that Soviet political economists saw. There were imperialist wars, defensive wars, and wars of liberation, you know? So in this situation, we can look at it through the lens of Soviet political economy. The Donetsk and Lugansk People's Republics declared independence through legal referendums, and then they were attacked by Kiev. So it was really the Ukrainian military that attacked sovereign republics. And so there, the war that went on between 2014 and 2022 before Russia's military operation was a defensive one. And now, after Russia's military operation began, it's become not a defensive war, but a war of liberation. And that's actually exactly what they call what's going on now in Lugansk and Donetsk. They call Russia's military operation освободительная война, a war of liberation. So they even think about it along Soviet socialist terms as well. This is like something that's like kind of like elementary to them. And for some reason, many people on the left don't understand that there are different types of reasons. There are different reasons for why people fight wars, you know? I mean, the biggest example that could be given to anyone is World War II, you know, where even, you know, so the Soviet Union fought alongside capitalist powers to destroy fascism. That's like the most clear example of why sometimes even, you know, you can be anti-war and sometimes support military action in certain situations.
Okay, we have somebody who hasn't asked. Trajan, if you could ask your question, followed by Raj, and then I think we're going to have to cut it because we have to let Don go. But go ahead, Trajan, if you would go ahead and ask your question.
It's first a statement. I got an email from some relatives who live in Kharkiv last week, and it was during the Orthodox Christmas. But they said that they went to their temple or church and was praying for peace. Many Ukrainians are for peace. They don't want this war. They don't want that war because they have said previously that they wanted a peace agreement from the start of it. They were praying for a peace agreement. But the media here makes it sound like that they all want to go for war. They don't. There's many civilians there that don't want to have the war. So I guess my question to Don is, do you agree what I'm saying?
I agree 100%. You know, that's actually why Zelensky was elected in the first place. Zelensky ran on a platform of ending the conflict in Donbass and having peaceful relations with Russia, if you can believe it. I don't know how many of you remember all that stuff from back then, but Zelensky was running on a peace platform, which was in direct opposition to Poroshenko, who was like a war hawk, who came to power right after the Euromaidan coup d'etat. Ukrainians elected Zelensky because they wanted a peaceful solution to all this and an end to the conflict because it was making everyone miserable. And Zelensky himself was a very popular comedian in Russia. And all of his skits, all of his work was in Russian. It wasn't, he didn't even, like some people say, he didn't even really know how to speak Ukrainian properly until he became president. I have a fiance, we live together, and you know, even we still watch some of the shows that Zelensky came up with from before all this, and they're hilarious, and they're like, they're focused around like Russian stuff. He was super popular in Russia and Ukraine, so that's also, you know, his reputation before he became president also lent to this idea that he would be able to have, you know, create better relations between Russia and Ukraine. I remember a Lugansk reporter asked me if things were going to change for the better after Zelensky became president, because even in Lugansk and Donetsk, people were really optimistic about this. And I remember I told him, no, I don't think it's going to get any better, because Zelensky's just one man, you know, and this whole situation is much bigger than just one person. And I remember the reporter didn't like my response, and I don't think she put it in her report. But unfortunately, you know, I was right about that. And the people who really run the show in the Ukrainian government, and we all know who that is, obviously, you know, Washington, NATO, foreign powers, they basically forced him to get with the program, you know, so.
Okay, last question, Raj. If you'd unmute yourself.
Okay, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, thank you. I agree, this is a war of liberation. It's very similar to India going into East Pakistan, creating Bangladesh, which was a war of liberation. And this is very similar, except that here, even the Russians in this area came from Mother Russia. They are part of it. So it's not difficult for me. I don't know why the left here is so confused. But my question is, again, along the same line, Putin said Lenin is to blame for this situation. And as I see it, without Lenin's thesis on freedom for oppressed nationalities to leave, without that, revolution would not have held, nor they would have held. Doesn't Putin understand that? How can he say Lenin was to blame for it? What do you think of that? That's my question.
I think it's complete nonsense. This is like probably one of my biggest criticisms of Putin when he said that. I completely disagree with this position, especially because it reflects a sort of like historical misunderstanding of how Ukraine formed also. You know, like he says that this is Lenin's fault, because I think the Putin administration and like Putin, hardcore Putin supporters, see Soviet history as like, you know, in a similar way to the way Western liberals do, actually, you know, because even Putin has called the Soviet Union totalitarian at times. And this is like the most startling thing about the Putin administration. You know, I hate when he panders to these right wingers and these oligarchs and stuff. These are my biggest criticisms, because he says that Ukraine was like a project of Lenin and like the Bolsheviks in Moscow. Totally not true. Like he brings attention to the fact that yes, Donbass was not historically part of Ukraine. That's true, but there was no Ukrainian nation state before that. Yes, the people of the Donbass region were ethnically different from the areas around Kiev, but the around the time of the Russian Revolution, like various governments were forming, and it wasn't it didn't have to do with ethnic lines, to be honest. There was the first communist formation in Ukraine around the time of the revolution was called the Kharkov Congress, and it was like a congress of Ukrainian communists that met in Kharkov to try and form a Soviet government in that area, and it eventually became it eventually evolved into the Ukrainian Soviet Socialist Republic. But there were, around the time of the Civil War and the Revolution, there were a lot of factions and that controlled different parts. There was the German Empire that controlled parts of Ukraine. There was the Ukraine People's Republic, which was an anti-Soviet capitalist formation. There was the Ukrainian Socialist Republic. They were in favor. They were the Ukrainian Bolsheviks who had the support of Moscow. But there was also a separate republic in Donbass that was also socialist and Soviet. So yeah, at that point, Ukraine and Donbass were separate, even the socialist ones. And when Ukraine was formed, they were united. The Donbass, I think it was called the Donetsk Krishkova Republic, and there was also the Ukraine Soviet Republic. They ended up merging after all of the, you know, craziness of the civil war ended into one Ukraine. But that was done that was actually the will of the Ukrainian communists who lived there, because they were saying that they could not exist as separate entities and stand a chance against the threat of the German and Austro-Hungarian forces that were threatening to take even more of Ukraine than they had already at that point, because the Donbass region was primarily industrial, and the Ukrainian Soviet Socialist Republic before they merged was comprised only of farmland. So the Ukrainian Socialist Soviet Republic wanted to be one with Donbass so that they could unite their forces and so that they could all enjoy the fruits of the industrial production from the Donbass region. And Lenin and the Bolsheviks approved this plan, but it was not like a project of Lenin. It wasn't like Lenin came in and, you know, dictated to everyone how everything was going to go. Far from it. But that's the way Putin and his administration make this historical period out to be. So yeah, I totally don't think that's the reason for this conflict at all. I think this is like a textbook example of a consequence of the fall of the Soviet Union. Because even if you take what Putin says at face value with in terms of Ukraine, none of these problems would have happened if there was not the dissolution of the unitary economic system, and if there wasn't the dissolution of a state that actively took measures to suppress neo-Nazis in Ukraine. Because I've spoken to people, you know, who older people who lived in Ukraine, and they say like the neo-Nazis were always there. There were a lot less of them in Soviet times because the Ukrainian diaspora basically took a huge portion of the neo-Nazi collaborators to Canada and the United States, but they came back after the fall of the Soviet Union. And in Soviet Ukraine, where the neo-Nazis that stayed there, they could not say anything. They were repressed, and for good reason. Now we see, you know, the slogan "Slava Ukraine" was banned because it was a slogan of Nazi collaborators. It was banned in the Soviet Union, and now everyone is saying it like it's like some sort of liberal solidarity slogan with Ukraine. But if you look at historical footage of Nazi occupied Ukraine, it's their banners say Heil Hitler, Slava Ukraine. It was a Nazi collaborator slogan, and it was banned in the USSR. So yeah.
Just for clarification, I agree with you, but just for clarification, just quickly, mm-hmm. I don't think Putin is saying Ukraine should never have been invaded. What he meant was he accuses Lenin of giving Donbass, integrating it with Ukraine and giving Ukraine this way independence. They even under Stalin, they had membership in the United Nations along with Belarusian Socialist mm-hmm. Republic. So Lenin and Stalin were not different on this issue. But I think Putin means Donbass, for which he's fighting, was Lenin's fault. And you're saying that wasn't true. So I'm clear, unless you want to say something on it.
Yeah, I just thought because Putin talks about several like quote unquote mistakes that Lenin made with the formation of Ukraine. I thought you were talking about because Putin criticizes also Lenin for creating. He says Ukraine was created arbitrarily, you know, because of the different. There were ethnic differences between the people who lived in Donbass and Ukraine. And he says that Lenin just drew the borders arbitrarily, even though it was the will of the Ukrainian people and the Donbass people there as well. But in terms of what you're saying, yeah, also this was this doesn't represent a like divergence between the Leninist line and what Stalin was doing either. And there was, and again, like there was never this problem of separatism in the Soviet Union. This all emerged after the fall of the Soviet Union. That's the big problem, because the unitary system fell apart, and then all these neo-Nazis were allowed to say whatever they wanted, you know, and organize. That was the biggest problem.
Is Yeltsin to blame for
okay, it? Okay, Raj, we're gonna move on now.
Okay.
I wanna ask people to hang on for a moment. First of all, I wanna recommend to people to check out Don's YouTube channel, The Revolution Report. You can search for it on YouTube, The Revolution Report. Yeah. It's really an excellent source of information about Russia and the Soviet Union. A lot of pieces that he's done on history and people's attitudes within Russia towards the Soviet Union and towards socialism. So check out The Revolution Report on YouTube. Second of all, we want to thank Don for stepping up, and this was really an excellent program. Thank you for making the documentary. And you know, we're starving for information here in the West. We live in a totalitarian society where I think we just are not getting any information about what's actually going on in the world, and certainly in Russia and Ukraine. I want to thank you for your work in doing the documentary and your reporting on RT, and for joining us tonight. We really, really appreciate it. Also want to offer you congratulations on your engagement. And if you want to, on your honeymoon, come back to the States and visit the San Francisco Bay Area. We will, I promise you, we'll take very good care of you and your wife when you come.
Okay.
Okay. Thanks. So thanks, Don. Everybody else, please stay on for a moment. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Okay. Bye-bye. Jean, bye-bye. Could you please let us know what's happening, what's going up? Thanks.
Like I know what's going on.
okay.
Yeah, well, we have some great programs coming in terms of our future programs. Again, these are all listed on not only our regular email announcements, which you can subscribe to on our website, icssmarks.org. But we have some great programs. First of all, next week we have actually nuclear weapons and the Ukraine crisis with our speaker is Mark Albertson. And we're looking forward to that and kind of a continuation of our discussion of these topics. January 29th, the militarization of the police. And our speaker there is Steve Martineau. Many of us, he hangs out at the library when the library was open before the pandemic. And then again on February 5th, we have Mark Albertson back to speak on Hitler's rise to power. And then after February 12th, we have our friend Yusuf speaking on Stalin's book, Marxism and the Problems of Linguistics, which is not as esoteric because he will also go into, I believe, the national question. So we got some great programs coming up, and thanks everybody for everything you're doing.
Thank you very much. And again, we want to urge people to go to the website, icssmarks.org, sign up for our email notification. There's also a place where you can make donations. There's a menu choice for making donations with information about that. Want to thank everybody. I'll keep it open for a few minutes for people who want to stick around and have a discussion. But thank you very much. Want to apologize for the disruption. I'll try to find out what happened with Jeff. I suspect that it may be some communication issue because I was in pretty close contact with him leading up to this morning. I'm not sure what happened. And apparently Don was having trouble reaching him too. So, but I think it worked out really well. Thank you guys for your questions and really good session. And check out the Revolution Report. It's really very good. So thank you.
Can I ask Richard Wright what he means by they have a tent just waiting for you?
We're going to, Alan invited Don to spend his honeymoon here.
Yeah, I was being funny, Norma. Come on, get with the program.
Institute for the Critical Study of Society at the Niebuhr-Proctor Marxist Library receives no corporate funding, nor do we have any paid staff. We rely on the support of working class folks that share our commitment to the socialist legacy of Karl Marx. We continue to need funds to meet necessary expenses, since we can no longer pass the hat at our in-person forums. Please send contributions to our treasurer, either online via PayPal or by check. The PayPal ID is ICSS Sunday, S-U-N-D-A-Y, at yahoo.com. And the name is Richard Fallenbaum. And checks may be made out to Richard Fallenbaum and sent to him at 1225 Nielsen Street, Berkeley, California, 94706. Fallenbaum is spelled F-A-L-L-E-N-B-A-U-M. To donate directly to the Marxist Library, send a check to the Niebuhr-Proctor Marxist Library at 6501 Telegraph Avenue, Oakland, California, 94609. Or directly or donate online at www.paypal.me/npml. Info for information, write to npml at marxistlibr.org. And the website is marxistlibr.org.